Hello, and welcome to the Photon Framework course brought to you by CJR Gaming. My name is Christian Richards, and in this episode, we'll be taking a look at getting the server portion of the framework up and running. Last time we left off, I created the Photon event, and unfortunately, I forgot to change the message type from request to async. Once that's done, we're going to want to begin with our Photon server peer. At first, we want to go ahead and have it inherit from server peer base, which is part of the actual Photon framework. So we need to go ahead and add those references in. Again, from before, I usually keep them on the root of my C drive in the directory Photon, jump over to lib, and we're going to go ahead and grab the logging log for net, the exit games libs, Photon socket server, the Photon host runtime interfaces, and I believe that's all we need right there. So we'll go ahead and add those in, which should allow us to set the using of the server peer base. And then we're going to go ahead and begin implementing some functionality for this. Start off with the constructor. And the constructor is going to take in an IRPC protocol, which we'll just call protocol. The IPhotonPeer. The Photon server handler list, which we'll be covering here shortly, and the Photon application. With that, we're going to go ahead and call base, meaning our server peer base, and we're going to pass in the protocol and the Photon peer so that it can go ahead and actually create us the server peer base. Now, if you don't notice, those things are only showing up in red, and that is because I'm not using ReSharper on this computer right now. It's just basic default stuff. And with those in, we'll now go ahead and do underscore handler list equals handler list and server equals application. Go ahead and create those. So we'll start off with a private read-only Photon server handler list called underscore handler and a protected read-only Photon application called server. So that should give us that. Oops, and this needs to be handler list, not handler. All right, so the only thing we're really missing is creating this class here, but before we do that, we're going to go ahead and finish filling out the rest of our Photon server peer. The next thing we'll create is a protected override, and we're going to call this one, we're going to go with on operation request. And it is going to just do underscore handler list dot handle message. And we're actually going to create a new object out of our actual operation request, turning it into a Photon request, passing in the operation request's operation code, the operation request's parameters, And one of the things that we have to do here is because of the way we're going to set up between either having multiple subservers or a single server, we need to find out if it contains a key, and if that key is the server.subcodeParameterCode. Now, I'll get into that a little bit later, but what it is because we're building this framework, and if someone else were to come along and create some other stuff for the framework, we need a way to tell the server what key to look for the subcodes. And in this case, I just called it server.subcodeParameterKey, and we'll be filling that out a little bit later. Now, if that key exists, what we're going to do is we're going to cast this next value to a nullable int, meaning an int that actually has a couple extra values of has value and the actual value of the integer. And we're going to do a convert.toInt32. And what that is going to need to be is the operation request.parameters. And then, you guessed it, server.subcodeParameterCode. And if that doesn't exist, then we're just going to pass in null for that int. And the last thing we need is the rest of the operation request parameters. And then the handle message will also take in the server peer that is making the call, so that in case we need any additional data out of our subserver, we can go ahead and get to that information. The other functions that are that we created before are the protected, override. And so we still have the on operation response and on event. So we'll go ahead and implement both of those as well. They are almost exactly the same as our request. The only difference being that we are going to create, instead of a photon request, we're going to need to take in a photon event, which is then going to take the event data dot, and instead of operation code, it's just dot code. We're going to need the event data parameters and see if it contains a subcode, just like before. We'll also need to take that same value and put it in here to the convert, and then also bring in the rest of the parameters for that event data. And then, just like before, with the protected override for on operation response, same code as before, although again, just like before, instead of this being a photon event, this is going to be a photon response. And then it's going to be an operation response dot operation code, the operation response parameters, casting that again to an int, and then the parameters from that. And then the other thing that we'll use along with this, with the operation response, is we'll also pass along the operation response dot return code and the operation response dot debug message. All right, so there we've got all of those implemented. The other thing that needs to be noted is that we are going to need to create a factory method for this for this class. Now what the factory method is going to do is when we use AutoFac, when we go to create these things, some of this data is static all the time, and some of this data is not static, meaning it's something that gets passed along to the class from another class. So like our Photon server handler list will be in our container, we'll be able to grab that out no problem. Same with the application. But the RPC protocol and the Photon peer is going to be different for every single peer that connects. So I'm just going to go ahead and put in a region. I'm going to call this factory method and go ahead and end the region. And then within this block, I'm going to put in a public delegate that returns a Photon server peer. I'm going to call it just factory so that we know that it is a factory method. It's going to give us an IRPC protocol and an IPhoton peer. And that's all there is to it. With that, we have everything in place for our Photon server peer. So anytime a peer connects, it will be able to handle operation requests, handle events, handle responses, all from its server handler list that we'll be creating here momentarily. And then because of this factory method, I'll show later when we get to AutoFac that we'll be able to send in the specific RPC protocol and specific Photon peer for each server that connects every time. From here, I'm going to go ahead and just I'm going to generate a class for the Photon server handler. It'll also reside in the MMO Photon server namespace. And we're going to go ahead and say public class and make sure that this is also public here on the Photon server peer. Otherwise, you won't be able to see it from outside of this DLL. We'll start off by creating our public Photon server handler list. It is going to take in an IEnumerable. Now the IEnumerable, when it comes to the AutoFac container, can return multiple results of the same kind of thing. In this case, it's going to be an IHandler, and it's going to be an IHandler that takes in Photon server handlers. And really quickly, I will need to go in and use the MMO Photon framework. There we go. Call this handlers. And then it's also going to take in the default request handler. The default response handler. And the default event handler. And again, AutoFac will provide all of these to us automatically whenever a new Photon server handler needs to be created. And we're going to take those things and we're going to go ahead and populate them into the values, the attributes we're about to create. So we'll start off with a default request handler. We'll also create one for the response. And then we'll also create one for the event. The next thing we're going to do is we're also going to have three lists. One for the request handlers, and it's going to be a new dictionary, and it's going to be populated by ints and Photon server handlers. And we're going to have the same thing twice more, one for responses and one for events. And again, these will all take in just generic Photon server handlers. And as part of this list of handlers, we're going to go ahead and add them in programmatically. So we're going to say for each Photon server handler in the list of handlers, we're going to say if not register handler handler, then we're going to go ahead and log dot warn format, and we're just going to leave a little message for ourselves to say that we attempted to register a handler that we already have a value for. And then I'm just going to do a handler.getType.name so that we know the actual name of the handler. The type of the handler. And the code that will that it uses as well. All right, so with all of those, we'll go ahead and start creating these. These are all going to be either private or protected, read-only. And the reason we're doing read-only is because it gets injected through the creation of the, or through the constructor. And so the values won't ever change in these things. So we have our default request handler, our default response handler, and our default event handler. Like that. There we go. And then we'll have our protected read-only iLogger log. And the other thing that this does for us is that it also creates in our server handler list, it creates us a log for use anytime we even override this class. And it seems that I need to go ahead and add another reference, which is the log for netDLL. And once that's in place, we should be able to use the log for net, which will give us access to, We want to use the other one. There we are. So there, now we have that in place. And then lastly, we're going to need to create these dictionaries here. So these are again going to be private read-only dictionaries of type int and photon server handler. And this one is going to be the request handler. And then we need two more, one for our response, one for our event. And now we at least need this register handler function, as well as our handle message function that our other that our Photon server peer is relying on. So the register handler is going to be a public bool. Going to take in a Photon server handler that we'll just call handler. All right, so that gives us that. First, we're going to go ahead and make sure that we have our return value, like so. And then here comes a nice giant if case. Now the reason we have to use ifs instead of a case is because we're actually doing some Boolean checking on our values. The reason we're doing that is because we have the potential to create one handler that handles requests, responses, and events all of the same type. Normally, I wouldn't see a use for it, but I did code it just in case we need the flexibility. So we'll just say handler.type and message type.request. And if that equals message type.request, then what we're going to do is first we need to check, like I was saying before, we have the subcode that may or may not exist. So first we have to ask if handler.subcode.hasValue. And again, if I hover over this, you'll see that it's a nullable int, meaning that we have these hasValue and value options instead of actually having just whatever the int value is. And that way we can possibly have it to where it doesn't have an actual value. So first we check to see if it has a value. If it has a value, then we also want to see if our request handler list already contains this subcode. If it does, or rather if it doesn't, then we're going to go ahead and have our request handler add the handler.code. Now again, you might be asking, well, why would you add the code rather than the subcode? Oops, and that would be because I was making a typo. We actually do want the subcode.value. We can also go ahead and write a log if we want, but I'm just going to say registered equals true. And now we're going to need the reverse here. So we'll say else if not request handler list dot contains key. And this is where we need the handler dot code. So if it doesn't have a subcode, or if it already contains that subcode, we're going to go ahead and try and add it by its code as a generic catch-all. If that works, then we're going to do the request event handler dot add, and we're going to take in the handler dot code that I was trying to type in earlier, and then the handler itself. And lastly, we can have an else in here that says something like, and I'm not sure why I made it a comment. Let's go ahead and uncomment that. And then we'll pass in the handler.code. And then again, just so that we know for sure what type we're dealing with, we're going to go ahead and do handler.getType.name. And that just makes it a little bit easier for debugging, so we can run and find out what handler is causing the exception, which will help you look for what subcode or what code it might be using that's already being added to our list. We have that done, and that's just for one. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to copy this entire set of code. We're going to paste it in here, and then change all these values around from request to response. Response handler list already contains those values. And then, yes, just like the request and the response, we will also have the event, or sorry, async. So there's that. Change these around. Did I not call it event handler? Ah, I called it events with an S. Let's go ahead and take out that S. There we go. All right, so that is our register handler. So we can register it multiple times even if we need it to do it for requests and responses. Or in the case of when we get to the multiple server, you'll see one that we create that's for response and events. And what that's going to do is anytime we receive a response and an event, we're going to have a default handler that checks to see if it needs to go to a client, and then those are just going to automatically go to a client registering with one handler instead of creating multiple handlers for each type that could go back. The last function we're going to create for this class and for the evening is a public bool handle message. It's going to take in an iMessage and a Photon server peer, which is again the one that sent it, so that we have a way of getting back to whichever one it is. There we go. So we're going to start off again by creating our handled return. Handled. And this time we'll actually be able to use a switch. Since anytime we're handling a message will only come in with one particular type. So we've got our type. Our first case is going to be on message type.request. And much like before, the code is going to be somewhat similar, just between the three different types. So we'll say if message.subcode.hasValue and requestHandlerList.containsKey. What we'll go ahead and do is we'll do underscore request handler list submessage dot subcode dot value, and we're just going to tell it to handle the message. Now, like before, we also have the possibility that we don't have a subcode. So we'll say if not message.subcode.hasValue and requestHandlerList.containsKey, and instead this time we'll be using the message.code, then we'll end up doing the exact same thing as before. Except that we'll be using the code to send our message along, and we'll also set it equal to true, the handled to true. And then the last thing we're going to do is if all else fails, this is where we actually call our default request handler dot handle message and pass in the message and the peer. So there we have that. Last thing we need to do is go ahead and add in a break for our case. And we're just going to copy this code and paste it in place for our response. And like before, this will then change to a response handler list. change it there, change it here, and then this will then become the default response handler handle message. And then the last thing we'll do is we'll go ahead and do one more for our async, which will then go to an event handler list and go to the default event handler, like so. And then I don't even worry about putting in a default because, again, we're using a all the values from within our message type. You can if you want. And then we return the handled. And so there we have our server handler. It goes ahead and gets its data from the server peer anytime we need to handle an operation request, an event, or a response. Now, in order to get this to compile, we're going to go ahead and add in this server piece to our Photon application. So we'll go ahead and jump over Photon application. And we are going to do a public abstract byte subcode parameter code. And we're just going to provide it with a get function. So what'll happen is when we create our other clients, let's say that the values are different for whatever reason. Each time you create a new subserver, you can go ahead and provide a different subcode parameter. I wouldn't recommend it. I'd use the same one because there are times where I have run into using two different values within the same within two different enumerations, and it causes all kinds of grief. But it is there primarily so that we can write the framework without having to provide a default parameter code. Much like what Photon went through, they had several codes that were specified to specific integers, and they ended up needing to change them as things changed because people needed access to other integers and didn't want to have to use those, you know, didn't want to overwrite those values because it causes default behaviors to change. So in this case, it's just a matter of us being able to provide the parameter code based on our own enumerations that we create later on down the line. So there we have our server peer, our server handler. So the issue we were running into is the fact that our Photon request and Photon event both have this additional string debug message and short return code that is not supposed to be there. So if we go ahead and come in here and remove both of those values and save those files, go back into our Photon server peer, our Photon response needs to then have these two values reversed instead of the return code and the debug message. We need to flip those around so that it's now in the correct order. We also then called our subcode parameter key. And if we look inside of the Photon application, we had originally called it subcode parameter code, which I have then gone into and updated. So if we save that, the last thing we have is that our Photon event is complaining that we did not implement the interface member, and that is because when I was typing this out, I called it parameters instead of parameters. And so if I go in and update all three of those, we can save those files. And then the last thing it's complaining about here is in the on disconnect. Just like we had previously, this code then also needs to have the on disconnect function written in. So if we go ahead and put it in, it's going to be a protected override void on disconnect, taking in the disconnect reason and the string reason detail. And all we're going to do here is we're going to say server dot connection collection dot on disconnect and pass in this. Now, this function doesn't exist right now, mainly because we have not created our connection collection class, which we'll be covering in a couple more videos. If you want, you can go ahead and just comment out this chunk of code. And the last thing is, in these things, I mistyped again. So I've got subcode parameter key and subcode parameter code. Go ahead and update those so that they are all the same rather than using different values. And that'll make it so that we can go ahead and build. And the only thing we'll run into is our connection collection, which, like I said, we'll be covering in a couple more videos. Till then.